Hello. Can I speak to Omarion?
Who is this?
Hey, how you doing? I feel kind of silly doing this, but this is the bush. This is the coffee house on MLK and Rosa Park. You know, the one with the forest natural. I see you on Thursdays all the time. You come in every Thursday on your lunch break, I think. And you always order the special with the organic chai latte. My manager be tripping and stuff, talking about we gotta use water. But I always use some hemp milk for you, because I think you're kind of sweet.
How did you get my number?
You always got on some fly blue tracksuit, and your Air Force Ones are shining all bright.
Thanks. For real though, who is this?
So, look man, I mean, I don't want to waste your time, but I don't usually do this. And I was wondering if maybe we could get together outside the coffee shop one day, because I do look a lot different outside of my work clothes.
Okay.
I mean, I got an art show coming up soon. Yeah, I'm an artist. Maybe you could come out and support? Wait, hold up. My cell phone's breaking up. Hold up. Can you hear me now? Yeah, so, what did you say? Can you come to my show?
Hey y'all, welcome to Who All Gonna Be There, a podcast by artists for artists. We talk cash shit about everything, sometimes we get messy, and it all counts as art because we say so. I'm Mel, I'm black, I'm a woman, phenomenally. I have all the jobs, none of them are essential. This week, I'm a notary public, a SoundCloud artist public relations specialist, and I also enjoy bird watching as a professional hobby.
Hell yeah. I'm Maximiliano, a.k.a. Maxi Max, a.k.a. Mad Max, wandering the wasteland for easels and oil paints. I just, like, rethought of one of the very intro lines of, and it all counts as art. I think that's a nice thing to always remember.
Yes.
For those of you sitting at home, or, listening on your jogs or jaunts around town, here is how you can support Nat Turner Project. We have a Patreon page, exclusive podcast episodes, which are only available behind the paywall. So we get extra messy.
Extra, extra. And we got a good one coming up, y'all.
Yes, we do. We have an Etsy store where you can buy our merchandise and buy our publications. You can subscribe to us on iTunes and leave a review. Hopefully a good one, but whatever. We've just only had bots so far. And we're still looking for those comments. Follow us on SoundCloud, Spotify, YouTube, Stitcher, Facebook, Instagram. Art-related questions about Nat Turner Project, questions about the universe, questions about whatever, sending them our way. Email us at natturnerproject0@gmail.com and we will read it on air and try our best to answer them, and potentially you will win a Nat Turner Project prize.
Yeah, we got some extra tote bags, and I'm not saying we're going to give them out, but I'm not saying we're not going to give them out. So.
Yes. You're more generous than NPR.
Wait, if we're trying to do NPR, should I speak like this in a really soothing voice? All right, y'all. Today it's just us. We figured we'd throw an episode on here today because there has been a lot going down over the past week. And we wanted to check in with y'all and drop some thoughts on some of it, just to let y'all know where we stand. So, first up, we are knee-deep in, what, month three? Is it month three yet?
Yes.
Month three of that quarantine life. Max, how are you doing?
I'm hanging in there. I am you know, life's a roller coaster. I'm having certain days and certain other days, and I'm developing new habits and mm-hmm. new activities.
Wait, what kind of new habits and new activities?
Wait, sorry, you said something.
What kind of new habits and new activities?
Well, this one's more positive. I've ordered a soccer ball online and have since inflated it, and sometimes wake up real early and go to the empty schoolyard and kick the ball around.
Oh, shit. I didn't even know you played soccer like that. You know I play soccer, right, in high school?
Oh, shit. I played up until I was like 12 or 13.
Oh, nice. What position?
I played mostly like the right defense.
Oh, wait, you broke up a little there. What position?
I play mostly the right defensive position.
Oh, okay. I was midfielder and forward sometimes.
Okay, goal scorer.
Yeah. Nice, yeah. We should play sometime.
Yeah, that's a social distance thing you can do. You can pick the ball from more than 6 feet.
I don't know, I was a little dirty. I got up real close and clipped some people a couple of times as a soccer player.
That's fair. I think it's all, even like, even the dark arts are still within the game.
Indeed. Aren't they, though? Like, aren't they?
Mm-hmm. I think honor is only a certain percentage of the game.
Seriously.
Yeah.
I love soccer, though.
It only appeals to certain people's strengths.
I've seen some really gruesome scenes on the soccer field back from my days. It got pretty intense. So.
Shit.
But yeah, shit, that's cool. Like, that's cool that you're going out. Honestly, the only going out I've been doing is going to the mailbox. I'm trying to work myself up to getting in the car and going on drives, but I'm just really nervous about being out there right now.
Yeah.
Just being someone who is immunosuppressed and at risk for if and when I contract this thing. So, yeah.
Yeah, shit. Yeah. Are you just, like, driving your car? You're, like, going to places?
No, I haven't, but I want to. Like, oh, okay. I'm debating doing that today. Like, the only place I've been... Okay, and this is a fucked up story. last month... I was bit by the dog in the house, so I had to go to the hospital to get like a tetanus shot and antibiotics, and that was pretty intense. But to be fair, like, the hospital was like super on top of their shit in terms of protocol and PPE. And, like, they had people at the entrance. Like, the person I came with couldn't come into the building. Like, and it was just me. And because I had an appointment and I had to get, like, a bracelet certifying that I was authorized to be there. Like, they were on top of their shit. And I think that's one of the reasons why Oregon is kind of, like, on the better end of what's happening in this country right now. Besides it being less densely populated. So that was cool. But it was nice to be out and driving and stuff. But one of the things I noticed is that nobody was wearing a fucking mask while I was out there. Like, on the street. So that was weird. But I do kind of want to drive around in my car and stuff. Because that seems to be relatively safe. And just, like, take a break. Because I've been in this house for, like, 3 months, and then there were the 3 months before all this popped off where I was just bedridden, so, like, you know, it starts to add up.
Yeah, you want to see some things.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, what about, like, what new movies or shows or books are you getting into right now?
Thank you for asking, Melanie.
I try. I'm a considerate person.
Since we were talking about soccer earlier, I've actually watched a few soccer things on Netflix recently.
Oh.
The first was a movie about Italian soccer fans, the, like, super fanatical ones. And there's just about a group of them in Naples. It was an alright movie.
What's it called?
Ultras.
Huh.
It's on Netflix. What else? I saw this documentary about this Israeli soccer team. And from Jerusalem, that plays in Jerusalem. And I guess it's back in like 2012 or whatever. But so the documentary is about one season where these two Chechen Muslim players come to the team. Like the owner brings them to try to like promote some stuff, promote diversity and change. But then like a lot of the fans think it's just like bullshit, like a bullshit PR stunt. And like all the fans are Israeli and Jewish, and like the ultra fans, the fanatical fans are like, you know, proudly racist and like have chants that say like they're the most racist team. So the season's like, it's pretty much about that season with these two players that are Chechen, but they get called Arab all the time. I think because like they're both Muslim, and most of the players on the team don't like them and don't associate with them. Then there's a few that try to, and like the captain of the team, who was used to be beloved by the fans, and then he spoke out in support for these two new Chechen players, is now like defiled by the fans, and like him dealing with that, going from like the captain of the team that everybody loved to like, you know, fuck that guy. that guy's a traitor and stuff. So that was interesting, an interesting documentary. But soccer themed.
Nice.
What have you been consuming?
A couple things. On Netflix, I binge watched this series called Blood and Water, and it's this South African series, and it's basically like, imagine if Gossip Girls was actually good and had character development, and most of the characters were black. That's what Blood and Water was. So it's this intrigue around a girl whose father, whose sister was kidnapped when she was a newborn, 17 years ago, and her father is currently up for charges for being involved in that kidnapping, this child trafficking thing, and she ends up running into this girl at a party, at this posh party, who she thinks might be her sister. So she, like, requests to, like, transfer schools and infiltrate and try and, like, figure out if this girl is her sister. It's actually really fucking good. And obviously there's that kind of, like, uncomfortable element. Like, I'm really creeped out watching actors who play teenagers embroiled in, like, these weird love stories and these scenes and stuff. But other than that, it was cool. And also I started watching this show on Hulu called The Great, which is about Catherine the Great and her dumbass husband. And it's like this dark comedy, which is hilarious and gross at times, but also really funny. Elle Fanning is the star, and she's really, really good at kind of like that deadpan comedy of like where weird fucked up shit happens to her, and she's like processing it in her facial expressions. It's really good. It's funny. It's fucked up, but it's funny.
She's Catherine the Great.
Yeah.
Okay.
And they like, she plays her like as this young, naive girl who thinks she's being married into this like relationship of love, and then slowly like it's revealed that her husband is an asshole. like the terrible things he does. It's just, it's fucked up, but it's hilarious. So, like,
I've never seen a Gossip Girl, but it's like rich young kids is the premise.
Yeah,
like, school together.
Rich young kids in Manhattan, which is its own thing. So
that's the same for the other show.
Rich kids,
it's like the rich young kids.
Yeah, in South Africa.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. And obviously there are like moral and ethical implications of like watching a show just about rich kids in South Africa, given South Africa's history. But, you know, I consume black content. I don't care. So, like...
Yeah, isn't there, like, moral implications about watching Gossip Girl?
Yeah, exactly. In terms of, like, books, and I know, like, you're probably going to say something much more smart than I am right now, and I'm embarrassed for myself, but I have been listening... No, I've been reading a lot of, like, dirty British smut romance literature lately. Because a lot, like, the ones that I've, a friend of mine put me on game to have, like, black femme protagonists. So it's been, like, really cool to read, like, these romance, like, novels or whatever featuring black women that are, like, kind of, like, dirty, but also really, like, insightful and heartfelt or whatever. So that's kind of what I've been into these days.
And they're all British?
Most of them are British, yes. And I don't know why that is. I don't know what that says about American romance novels, but...
Yeah, I haven't gotten there yet.
Maybe not, honestly. Yeah. What have you been reading?
This is one, I guess, I feel like I'm embarrassed it took me so long to get to. But I feel like it's very topical. I've been reading Parable of the Sower.
Oh, shit! A couple of friends specifically told me not to read those right now. How are they?
It's amazing. I've been, like, going through it pretty quickly. There's, like, a few parts I just had to stop, because then it gets, like, without giving things away, things get sad at certain points. So I was like, oh, I have to, like, you know, not read it for a few days. But right now it's at a fairly good part. I haven't finished it yet. I still maybe have like a fourth he left. But I've thoroughly enjoyed it, and it definitely feels so real. It's crazy that it was like it came out in like the 80s. But yeah, it feels so fucking spot on. It's insane.
Octavia's the GOAT. Like, Octavia Butler, Octavia Butler inspired an entire graphic novel series within myself that I didn't even know I had. Like, she's that fucking great. Like, she's amazing.
Yeah.
But I can only imagine that Parable of Sower gets really depressing at some point, so...
Yeah. but right now things are good, so... it's easy, it's, like, easier to read now, because I was like, oh, okay. Yeah, like, you're happy.
Yeah.
But...
One of my students, my former students, actually gifted me the graphic novel adaptation, which has been sitting on my dresser, because I'm waiting to crack that open, but I feel like I need to read the books first before I read that, so.
Yeah, that's cool that your student gave you that.
I know. It's pretty amazing.
Yeah. That was pretty badass.
Yeah.
I think maybe, like, once or twice I've given a teacher a gift, and that's only when I was, like, in elementary school or something.
Yeah.
Because, like, my parents, you know, like, give this to your teacher. That's cool, though.
Yeah. Let's see. So, should we talk about our spinoffs?
Yeah.
Okay. So, Who All Gonna Be There is branching out. We're doing some spinoff podcasts. We just released the first episode of Who All In It, which is a spinoff podcast with me and Ariella Tai, where we talk about films, global films, American, British, otherwise, through a critical race lens. Max, do you want to talk about your spinoff podcast?
I have a spinoff podcast coming as well, currently untitled. I know for the first episode, I'll have a couple guests, and we'll be talking about, the anime show, Evangelion.
Ooh, nice.
Neon Genesis Evangelion. But beyond that, what, other things will be covered or discussed, I guess, has yet to be seen. So, yeah, look out for that if you're, into that show. And, I'm selling it so well right now. You just wait.
That's exciting, because, like, I don't follow anime because I'm a contrarian, and everyone always just assumes because I'm a nerd that I should like anime, which made me never want to watch anime. So, I don't know, maybe when your spinoff drops, I'll actually attempt to watch one, just to follow along. That'd be cool.
Yeah, it's a good one. I mean, if there's ever one you watch.
Yeah. Do you know who your guest will be for the first?
It's going to be Ruben and Onyx.
Oh, nice. Ruben Garcia Marufo and Onyx, the artist?
Yeah, Onyx Andrea.
Nice.
They're both Superior Ava aficionados. I'm still new to it. I've only seen the show once, or one time through. But
how many episodes?
I think it's 26, but I guess the way you're supposed to watch it is there's 24, and then there's a movie that... so I guess originally the guy that created it came out with like 26 episodes. The last two episodes were like the ending, and then I think people didn't like them, or they were like weird or something. I don't know all the details, but then for some reason like a movie came out. He came out with like a movie shortly afterwards that became like the official ending, which is very different than the last two episodes.
That's
so cool. You're supposed to watch them up to 24 and then the movie, and then if you want you can watch the last two episodes. But yeah, so 26, 24 in a movie.
Nice. That's considered short, right, for an anime?
I don't know. I think a lot of animes are just two seasons. I think there's a lot that are like way longer, but I think there's like a lot that are just like 2 13 season episodes.
Okay.
Or 2 13 episode seasons.
Okay. Cool. That's exciting.
I'm not an anime expert at all, in the least bit.
Yeah. So. All right. Awesome. Well, I'm looking forward to hearing that. Do you know when that first episode will drop?
It's going to come out sometime in June, mid-June.
Nice, okay. Yeah, Who All In It, we're dropping an episode in mid-June. I think we're going to be reviewing See You Yesterday, which is a time travel flick on Netflix involving a young woman in Brooklyn with all kinds of nods to Back to the Future. And if anyone who knows me, they know that I love time travel, and I will watch or read damn near anything that has time travel in it. So, yeah. Cool.
How do y'all decide which movie you're going to watch?
It's kind of an organic process. We have, like, this long, ongoing list, and we just pick from those movies right now.
Is there, like, for time travel movies, do you like the more ridiculous, the better?
I mean, honestly, I feel like the more entertaining episodes to listen to would be the ones where we don't like the movies. So we're probably gonna aim for movies that we don't like as much. Cause like no one wants to hear an episode full of, oh, I love this scene and this scene and this scene, and like that's not as fun, right?
So. It makes you wonder about society.
How so, Max?
But people just want to hear something get torn down instead of hear something getting lifted up.
Touche.
No, I think that's cool though.
Yeah. No, I actually liked See You Yesterday, so that should be a fun episode. I thought it was really good. I've actually heard things from friends where they thought it was a little too on the nose or was too obvious, which I think is a thing that pretentious people say, but whatever. So, like, and I'm including myself because I know I've actually said that probably on this very podcast, so whatever. Fight me. So,
have you seen The Time Traveler's Wife?
Yes, I have seen that.
Do you like that one? Is that a good time travel movie?
I actually did like it, but I watched it many, many years ago. My politics have evolved. It'd be interesting to watch it again and see if I still like it. That's the tricky thing.
Yeah, I saw it for the first time, I think, sometime in undergrad, early undergrad, and I remember just, like, crying so much. And then, I think I've seen it, like, two more times, and I've still, like, just been, like, torn up the whole time.
Really? Okay, I need to watch it again. I wonder if it's on streaming right now. Okay.
I feel like maybe there was a time where I saw it on Netflix.
Yeah.
What other time travel movie? Because there was also About Time, which I felt like was a similar
premise.
Did you see that one?
I did see that one.
I think it also had Rachel McAdams.
Yeah, they both have Rachel McAdams, who I really like that actress. Because she's so earnest, you know? But the About Time was, I feel like that was a little bit too, like, it was all about him and his love. Nobody's here to watch your movie about your love. Nobody cares. So, like, I don't know.
Yeah.
It just felt...
Yeah, I'm trying to remember. He was just, like, reliving moments and fixing them. Was that his thing?
Yeah, and he, like, I remember at one point, sorry guys, spoiler alert, he fucks up and he ends up changing his child. Like, I remember that happens in About Time. Yeah.
Yeah. That's kind of like Butterfly Effect. Butterfly Effect, a time travel movie.
Did you like Butterfly Effect?
I remember thinking it was entertaining when I watched it, but probably not caring about it now.
I thought it was interesting. I know that there was an alternate ending. I can't remember what the alternate ending was, though.
I think the alternate ending was, like, he goes back and, like, chokes himself in his mother's womb.
That's right! Yes! Yes! He does. He kills himself.
Yeah.
Which, I mean, honestly, I feel like there were a lot of really interesting ideas in that movie. That was back when Ashton was trying to be an actor. Good for him. So, I guess now we got to talk about the things we came on here to talk about, right? Like the reason why we wanted to throw up an episode.
The shit in the news.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's do it.
So, if you're listening to this, I'm sure you already know we are in the midst of a global pandemic. We recently, I think as of 2 days ago, hit the 100,000 deaths mark in the States, making us the most affected from this, from the COVID-19. It is currently, and I looked up the numbers today, currently the U.S. is looking at 1.759 million coronavirus cases and 102,880 deaths. And this is according to worldometers.info, which I feel like is the most accurate depiction of numbers right now that I can find. It's this kind of weird disassociation thing. Like, I'm seeing these numbers, but it's too big for me to parse. It's too big for me to turn around or to deal with in my head. And I think that seems to be the case for a lot of people, because a lot of these states are currently reopening and they've decided they're going to good vibes only the coronavirus because they're tired of it. And they're going out there and pretending everything is A-okay.
Yeah, that's what's crazy is, like, yeah, that number versus what you, like, see when you, like, look outside your window.
Yeah.
Or the way, yeah, it seems like the world is just eager to jump back into it. And then that we've just, like, accepted that people will die and whoever dies, dies.
Yeah.
And that it's worth people getting haircuts and, you know, whatever else.
Yeah. Like, and, like, I have family in Atlanta, so I'm... friends and family. So I'm seeing a lot of people I know post, like, videos and photos of them going out and doing shit, or even, like, videos of people at, like, overcrowded parties and shit and gatherings at restaurants, and it's too fucking much. Like, is it this kind of underbelly where people are quietly just kind of resigned to this idea that sustaining this life that they live is worth the cost of dying? and killing people? Like, I'm trying to understand what's happening here, and I can't. I can't understand it. What do you think?
I think the people that are, like, not caring and going out are probably not worried about catching it. I think they, and probably aren't affected, probably haven't had friends or loved ones get sick or, pass away from this, I think. I think it's just the visibility of the separation between people that have been affected by COVID versus the people that haven't and are just ready to go back to their lives and see it as, like, something that's happening to other people or something that they don't need to worry about. And, because I think also it's that, but I also think, like, there's a part of human nature. Everybody thinks they're somehow, like, smarter than a thing, or thinking, like, oh, yeah, that's true. Like, everybody should do this, but it's okay if I don't do it, or it's fine if I make an exception for this, or, you know, but I really need to go do this thing, so that's okay if I go do that, you know? Yeah. I think it's just, like, individual selfishness.
Yeah. Which is...
'Cause I was sitting here excited. I was like, I'm gonna, like, just sit down and wait. Like, hopefully, you know, people stay inside long enough that things really do change. And, like, what does that new world look like? People, I think human nature, if, like, history tells us anything, right, human nature shows that people don't remember or learn from the past. So it's like, if we look, we can see that pandemics and things, and when, like, plagues and, like, disease come, sometimes they stay for, like, years or, like, you know, decades. And it affects, like, how people live for, like, a long time, and they're just, like, it comes in waves, right? It's just, like, every year, boom, here's this wave, boom, here's this wave. And then economy and, like, society does stunt in those times. And, you know, I think part of also, like, what we try to do as, like, a society and, like, civilization is try to, like, collectively, you know, exist better than that and try to, like, save people versus being like, oh, nature wants people dead, right?
Yeah. I honestly, I don't know what to say or do about any of this. My whole thing is, I'm just gonna stay in the house until it feels safe, and it does not feel anywhere near safe yet. And people just are out here being reckless. And I personally know people who have been affected by this. So maybe it's like what you said. Like, I know people who have been, like, directly impacted by this. So that's why I'm more vigilant. But, like, at this point, looking at the numbers, are there people who actually haven't been directly impacted by this? Like, the numbers are at 1.759 now.
Yeah, I know. It seems like some people feel like it's just some distant thing. Or they have been affected and they're thinking they're immune or oblivious. I don't know. But I think a lot of people just haven't been affected by it, or, you know, see it as something that's happening to somebody else.
Yeah.
Because at first we all felt like we were in it together, and then I was like, actually, are we? It's like people started picking their heads out and people started going outside, and then, you know, the sense of unity really, like, fell away, I think, quickly.
Yeah. I do think it's worth stating that I feel like when the numbers came out about how disproportionately Black people were affected by this, that something in this became racially coded. And that's when you saw people protesting at government capitals about stay-at-home orders, and people getting, and governors being sued, and people getting into physical fights about having to wear masks in public spaces. And I think that's real interesting to think about, how you turn a fucking pandemic into a racially coded war. Like, that's what it feels like. It feels like a fucking war, and I'm tired. I'm just tired. I don't know.
Yeah, no, I completely agree. From when the numbers come out, when the numbers came out, how protesting became, so politicized, so partisan. So it was like, very specific, like, MAGA group, you know, their rights were being infringed, and it became about guns, it became about Donald Trump, it became about, like, all these things. And then even in, like, the way quarantining and, like, social distancing is police, right? Like, those photos from, like, New York of, like, crowded white parks and then, like, a single black person getting tackled by, like, five cops, right, not wearing masks at all. Like, you know, that's, like, the absurdity. And, like, how many, like, ways can this, like, be so clearly shown the differences of people's experiences in America, right? White people, black people. It's insane. And yeah, like, white people don't give a fuck. It seems so obvious, right?
Yeah.
They just want their, like, frisbee in their parks and shit.
Yeah. They want their barbershop cuts, I guess.
They are, like, super cuts in a little barbershop.
Yes. And look, I can appreciate the need to be at a barbershop. My hair is starting to grow back after all the medical stuff, and it is in a crazy shape that I can't even fathom right now. Do you think I wouldn't love to be in a fucking barber chair right now and get this shit worked out? But no, I'm staying my ass in the house right now. Because it's not just about me going out and getting sick, it's about me going out, possibly already being sick, and infecting 10 to 20 other people I could kill. Like, why is no one thinking about that? I don't understand. It's hard for me to not get upset about this. I'm sorry. But just, like...
No, yeah, completely. It's like everybody becomes an additional chance of carrying it from place A to place B.
Yeah.
More people in a space means that it's, like, jumping around from people and surfaces more frequently.
Yeah.
And then I'll, like, even when I'm outside, I sort of still try to be... Like, I'm not going to touch anything. Like, I'll go outside... And, like, I'll see people, like, leaning on railings or, like, touching, like, the stop sign or, like, spotlights. It's like, why are you just, like, touching things you don't need to touch? You're like, you don't need to touch that at all. And it's like, you're just, like, touching shit. Just,
like, I don't understand.
But, yeah, who knows? Who fucking knows?
Yeah. Like I said, I have family in Atlanta, and I find myself, like, I have to call at least, like, once or twice every 2 days just to check in and make sure my family isn't getting stir-crazy and getting tempted to go out there, you know?
Yeah. My parents are in Texas.
Yeah.
And, they've, like, reopened. There's, like, restaurants you can go to now and stuff like that, but, they're still pretty much... just staying in the house and stuff. I guess my brother and his kids are also in Texas. I guess my nephew had a social distance, or not a drive-by birthday party last weekend, where he was out on his, like, apartment balcony with, like, balloons and stuff. And my mom sent me a video. She was, like, driving by in her car, yelling, of course. recording, like, right next to her face, but then just, like, the audio is so...
Your mom is awesome, by the way.
so it seems like they're still staying inside as much as possible.
Good. But you just know, like, them... Like, I feel like it's different for us in Oregon, because I feel like right now, knock on wood... People are still kind of, sort of abiding by stay-at-home orders in Multnomah County anyway. But, like, in places like Texas or Georgia, where, like, the leadership has basically decided we are starting this shit up, business as usual, it's got to be harder to stay at home in situations like that. Because everyone around you is acting so reckless and so crazy, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, because... your job is telling you to come back to work, all that shit's crazy. I'm sure it's even worse. And then because it is also so politicized, like, being around all those people that, like, hold this belief that this is, like, they're being a patriot by being outside, you know, like, that's just crazy that, like, I don't miss, like, that energy at all. I
mean, no. Also, do not miss that. What are you eating?
Almonds. Is it loud? Can you hear it?
No, you're good. All right. So, I guess we should talk about the curious case of Christian Cooper.
Yes.
AKA yes, the cacophony, the curious cacophony of Amy Cooper.
Yeah, it's always interesting to wake up in the morning to news of another Karen incident.
Yes. These Karens are out here wiling, just trying to get folks killed willy-nilly.
And you would think that would, like, start trying to, like, be more subtle, or, like, this one was so blatant, was so apparent.
It was creepy. Yeah. Should we talk about it? Like, the details or whatnot?
Yeah, we can if you want to. I guess we can assume people have seen the video.
Yeah, let's assume people have seen the video, because I'm not playing that video. I'm not adding a clip because it was so gross. So basically, this older gentleman named Christian Cooper, who is a queer rights activist and also has worked with Marvel as well. And is an avid bird watcher. I think they're called birders. That's some new information I learned. I had no idea. Was out and about in Central Park in this area that's known for, like, birding. And there was a random Karen there by the name of Amy Cooper who had her dog out and was unleashed, which is specifically against the rules of that particular part of Central Park, because it could affect the behavior of the bird life in that area. So, of course, he said something to her, and rather than taking heed and putting her dog on a fucking leash, Karen proceeds to go the fuck off, like a proper insane racist person, and starts cussing Christian Cooper out, approaching him menacingly. He, reading the room and understanding the landscape that we now live in, takes out his phone and starts recording her behavior. And she gets increasingly angrier about this, and threatens to call the cops and tell them that she is being threatened by an African American, even though she's the one who's coming at him, running up on him. And then she then proceeds to actually call the police officer, the police or whatever, and you see this, like, switch where her voice goes full on victim, white womanhood. And she, like, starts screeching in terror, like, I'm being threatened by an African American. All of this is caught on camera. And someone, I don't even think Christian Cooper actually posted it. I think it was someone who knows him who posted the video.
I think a relative.
Yeah, a relative. And it immediately went viral. So once it goes viral, to the layperson who doesn't know this, it automatically pops up on the radar of what I like to call, which is a term coined by the podcast The Black Guy Who Tips, Black Twitter CSI. It immediately pops up on the radar of Black Twitter CSI. And what that means is the person involved, the people or persons involved in the viral incident have a smooth 24 hours before Black Twitter CSI tracks down who they are, where they work, where they live, and every illegal incident they've ever been involved in. I think it took Black Twitter CSI a smooth 5 hours before they tracked this person down as Amy Cooper. They found out where she worked. They completely bombarded her workplace. And what essentially ended up happening is where she worked, they ended up firing her. I think she is currently being banned from Central Park all of Central Park, which is hilarious. I'm sorry, but that's fucking hilarious and the least they can do. Considering if those of us who consider ourselves historians, if we know the history of Central Park, Google that shit. Anyway, another thing that ended up happening, which weirded me out a little bit, is people then looked up Christian Cooper. And it turns out that he's a very, very attractive man. Very well spoken, has a Harvard degree, is kind of what they like to call hot nerd, I guess. And then began to sort of creepily fetishize him in this sort of perfect victim sort of thing, like this respectability politics thing that's just made me want to ease on back through the bushes like Homer Simpson. So that weirded me out. Like, it doesn't fucking matter what this guy looks like. Yes, he's hot. I get it. It doesn't matter that he has a Harvard degree. None of this shit matters. What matters is what this horrible woman did to him. And we should probably be focusing on that. Like, in a part, like, I was just like, okay, is it that black folks are just so happy that this did not end in tragedy so that we're focusing on, like, all of these quote-unquote positive things? Or is it that we just want to fetishize and make this sort of perfect victim thing? I don't know.
I think part of me thinks it is that thing that, like, you know, some people are, you know, like, do better in life, so therefore it's more tragic when something bad happens to them. But then I think there's another aspect that is, like, despite all these things, he was still just seen as, like, a black man, right, to this woman. Like, there's no, you know, that whole, like, thing about, like, there's no escaping it at the end of the day, right? As much, like, wealth or titles as, you know, as, like, as good as your education or whatever occupation you have, like, so I think potentially it's, like, yeah, it's both those things. I think it's still, like, even like, this can still doesn't save you from racism or from white people just, you know, essentializing you, simplifying you to, this black threat.
Yeah. That's fair. That's fair. It's just one of those kind of murky things, like...
Yeah. No, I definitely think it is the other thing as well, that, like, would this be, like, less tragic if he didn't go to Harvard? Would this be, like, less tragic for, like, all these other reasons? I definitely think that's there for sure.
Right. Yeah. 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 And then, like, Christian Cooper later came out and made a statement, and then... folks were like, he's not angry enough, he should be angry at her. And it was a whole sort of Botham Jean's brother thing again, where, like, we're dictating how angry the victim can be at the perpetrator. And I don't think that's cool either. If this guy thinks that he needs forgiveness in order to move forward in his life, let him have it. You don't get to say he's not allowed to be angry. That's not how that shit works. Can we be angry on his behalf? Yes, we can do that. A lot of us are. But we can't say he's not allowed to move past it. It's not on us. I don't know. What do you think?
Yeah, I think he can feel however he wants. I think this kind of, like, scenario potentially is, like, the best possible outcome. Like, you know, the police didn't come. The police didn't hurt him. She was found out very quickly, like, you know, he recorded everything, so the evidence is, like, clear as day, mm-hmm. about, like, how just made up, like, this shit is, and, like, how, like, not crazy that is, that, like, people do that, that, like, white people or white women, like, do this shit, that, like, it is real, like, just how easily they can, like, fake, you know, distress.
Yeah.
So I think, like, you know, the fact that he got it all on tape, you know, this lady has been, like, found out, fired from her job, you know, her life has been... Also, like, I also, like, read that her dog that I guess she adopted
like,
2 years ago, and that yes. dog has since been taken away from her, because throughout the video, she's also, like, choking the fuck out
yes!
of
her.
She's over here, like, calling the cops. office and was like choking the fuck out of her dog. That's not on a leash, you know.
Yes, Roy Woods Jr., who's one of the writers on The Daily Show with Trevor Noah, he posted a photo of the dog in police protective custody, like talking to a police officer, and like the caption was like the dog. Amy Cooper's dog making a statement about how he made it look worse so that she would get in trouble. But she was choking the fuck out of that dog. And the underlying joke that was running through Twitter that day was about how Amy Cooper suffered all these consequences more so for the way she treated her her dog than the way she treated Christian Cooper, which honestly... Where's the lie?
Right. Yeah, of course. Like, here's this video, very clear, and then everybody's like, did you see how she's treating the dog?
Oh my god.
Who's gonna advocate for this dog?
And Peter was like, we will not stand for this. Meanwhile, they're posting pictures of wings on MLK Day. Like, whatever. That's another conversation. So that's what had happened, like, was that Monday? Was that, like...
Yeah, that was only a few days ago.
Fucking honestly, 3 days ago!
It honestly, I've been, you know, my phone has been, it's pretty full memory-wise, so I'm, like, constantly needing to, like, delete things or take things off, so I'm like, oh shit, if that ever, like, something like that ever happened, like, would I be able to record a full video?
Oh, damn.
Like, do I have enough memory on my phone?
Shit.
Like, do I need to be prepared for that? Do I need to, like, walk around with, the, like, X amount of memory just in case I have to, like, record, like, my innocence in the thing?
Ooh. Yeah. But, the answer's yes, Max. Yes, you do.
I maybe I should upgrade to more memory or something.
Get a bigger card. Get a bigger SD card. I mean, I don't have an iPhone. I don't know how that works. Does iPhone photos. Take SD cards?
No, they, I don't know what's inside of them. They don't take anything. It's not like, I think there's something inside of them, but,
see, that's why I don't fuck with iPhones, because you can't control that. With an Android, you can just get a bigger SD card.
Really? That's nice.
Stay woke, Max.
Yeah. All right, Melody, I'm trying.
One thing that has been, so that was 3 days ago, and then immediately the next day, we as a people learned that even in the midst of a global pandemic in which people are dying, the police will still find the time to kill black folks. And that's when a lot of us awoke to our dismay to a video of George Floyd being murdered by police officers in Minneapolis. And before we get into that story, I just have a message about posting these videos. If you are a non-black person and you are posting these videos on your timeline, why? Why are you doing this? What is the fucking point? The people you're trying to quote-unquote convince cannot be convinced. They haven't been convinced in the past 8 fucking years or the past several centuries. They're not going to be convinced now. So what do you think a video is doing? What do you think?
Yeah, I think this kind of stuff, spreading this information, this news, is only news to white people and to non-black POC. Like, this isn't ever, like, news to black people. Black people are never surprised about how police are treating black people or what's happening to black people in America. So this idea, like, you know, I don't need to see this shit on my Instagram. I don't need to be alerted to the realities of America. It's only news, yeah, for, like, white people are the, like, I can't believe this shit's happening. Can you believe this shit? Like, yes, I can.
Yes.
You know, same for, like, non-black POC. I think, I think it's still, like, why are you posting this stuff? I think, you know, if there's anything to post, I think, you know, you can post data, statistics, articles. You don't need to post, video footage, right? I think that's ridiculous. I think, you know, so many, it brings up so many things, obviously, about how easy it is to just produce, reproduce Black Death, how casual, how the lack of value around the black body, how white people do it, how well-meaning white people do it, this fascination with, you know, Black Death and, like, gore and violence, under the guise of some type of, like, solidarity. I think it's uninterrogated, it's uncritical, it's lazy, and it's violent. It's just, you know, spreading violence.
Yeah. I couldn't have said it better. That's it right there. Uninterrogated, uncritical, lazy, and violent.
Yeah.
And it just makes me angry. Like, as a non-black person, posting what is essentially, what do they call them? Snuff films? Snuff films of black people. What do you feel in your soul when you post this video? Like, what does this do for you as a human being? Like, if that was your fucking, your daughter, or your son, or your aunt, or your uncle, or your mother, or your father, or your best friend, or your coworker, or your acquaintance, would you feel okay posting that shit? Like, what the fuck are you thinking? And are you thinking about the black people on your timeline who come across this? Like, I don't understand. I don't understand. And it never ceases to amaze me. Luckily, I feel like I have enough filters and mutes on so that I don't accidentally come across these videos. I've managed to actually avoid watching most of the videos that have happened in the last 8 years, thankfully. But I can't imagine what it does to someone who's like best friend or like partner or something posts some shit like this and they come across this with no warning. Like, that's got to be a fucking, like, psychological, like, downturn. I don't understand, like, why you would do this to another human being.
I don't think they're thinking on that level at all. Like, these are real people. They have people that love them, they have families, they have friends. These aren't just like some distant story, some like sensational images to spice up a story or a post. It's just crazy how can spread so you know, without consideration, so rapidly.
Yeah. And then meanwhile, like, as this kind of reverberates across, like, the country, we have a black trans man who was murdered in Tallahassee, Tony McDade, who was then subsequently misgendered, and then I couldn't find any fucking news articles on this. The only place I was able to find this was Twitter, because other black people are talking about it. And it's infuriating. And this is the problem I continue to have with this movement. Like, you have all this energy for this black cis males dying, and occasionally black cis women. But black trans folks have been dying across the board, both by police officers and other black people. And we're not, where's that same energy? Where's the same energy? Like, and I don't understand how you get to a point where you're fighting for black lives and black rights and excluding people. Like, how do you get there? What is the cognitive dissonance involved in that? I don't know. What do you think?
Yeah, no, it's definitely clear and, you know, like, abundantly obvious, the differences and reactions in and attention in media cover from, yeah, like, black men compared to, like, black women, black trans people. Yes, it's sad and unfortunate, and I think, you know, that needs to change, definitely. It is crazy, correct? Because even, you know, how long a crime or like a murder or death occurs before, you know, more attention is brought to it is like months sometimes, you know, so other times, like, of course, like never, you know, it's never brought up. But these are still, they're still the same story. So like why? I mean, obviously we know like why, you know, certain, you know, black men are given the most attention around this.
Yeah. And it's just, I can't fight for a thing that isn't about the thing it purports to be, you know? I don't know. I don't know what to do about this. Because it's been bothering me for a smooth decade now. So, I don't know, like, how do you reconcile this?
I don't know if I do reconcile it. I don't think it's reconcilable until it's changed. I mean, the fact that, like, we're, like, this, the, like, the conversation in itself is, like, more attention to like when police are killing black people, and then like the conversation in itself is like, it's crazy to even have this conversation that like, oh, we want you know, there's people not getting, there's like black people within the black community not getting enough of the attention when it comes to like police killing black people, that is still like, even within this idea of like police killing black people, that's something like to talk about. But I think the general idea in itself is like crazy that we're even having to like have this be a conversation and be a reality. But yeah, that is the reality, that you know, cops are killing black men, black trans people, black women, like all the time. And you know, we're only gonna hear about the highest percentage is gonna be black men. It's gonna be the thing that's like maybe most understood, most digestible, presentable. And then
and it comes back to this whole perfect victim thing. Like, we have seen through history, through recent history, that the perfect victim argument doesn't fucking work. It doesn't work. So why do you keep perpetuating this bullshit? Like, if you present a victim that is relatable to white, cis, middle-class audiences, what you're going to get is a watered-down version of the fix, I guess. You're gonna get a bullshit band-aid. We have seen this happen, we know it's going to continue to happen, and yet we keep falling into the same fucking pattern over and over again. And I'm tired. I'm just tired.
Yeah, no, it's definitely like, how do you get your oppressor to sympathize with you? And then it's like through speaking some version of their language, and that only furthers the thing, like only furthers the oppression, only furthers the violence. Yeah, and it's like, how does that change? What do we do to make that not the case? Obviously, I think it's important to change that within ourselves.
Yeah.
More importantly than like seeking sympathy from white people, or like, how do we seek sympathy from white people? And who's saying like, you know, the ways to seek sympathy, and like sympathy from whom? Like, which, like, white people?
Do you think
it's all fucked up.
You think we need to work on seeking sympathy from ourselves? Is that what it is?
Yeah, I think so. I think obviously we need to like you know, make queer people and trans people and women within the black community obviously need to become elevated, even with like in ourselves, outside of what white people think of like any aspect of us and ourselves.
Yeah, you think that's possible?
I hope that's possible. I don't think, like, I think, you know, we're talking about like all these like external, internal things within like the black community, but I think it always seems like internally to get united and like healed and healthy first, versus to face like external threats.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. It's a lot. And the thing I struggle with is, like, these are things that we need to do, but is this something that humanity at large is capable of? You know?
I like to think we have the capability for sure. I think so much of like how we are is learned, and you know, I think if people were like raised completely differently than how they are raised now, like I think they would behave and act differently. I think it's so much of like the world we're brought into and like what we're taught to like think and value and stuff like that. So I think people are definitely like capable of change. I think we're capable of being like molded into like whatever shape society like molds us into. But I think, you know, are we able to change society? I don't know. I don't know if it's like things like, you know, pandemics or stuff that like outside factors that become the big change that like we adapt to versus like, you know, movements or people.
Yeah.
I think those like cause change too, but maybe, you know, exterior realities make more change.
Yeah. I mean, if there's a better time to experiment, pandemic would be it. Like, we're literally watching things happen that we were told could never happen, right? That little that stupid ass stimulus check we got, we were told, my whole lifetime I was told that reparations were not possible, they were not viable, but meanwhile people can get, everyone in America can get, every taxpayer in America can get checks of $1,200, and they're contemplating a second one. We're seeing in other countries that they're able to do this. We have seen in other countries all along that they're able to do this. So, like, it's that thing of, like, contemplating the lies that we have grown accustomed to believing as truth, you know?
Yeah, no, I think yeah, you hit the nail on the hammer. I think that's exactly that. We accept some things as reality, as like this is the way it's always been and the way it always will be, versus like things that we think we have like a change in, but in reality like we can change, like we could change any of it. And I think, yeah, it is like getting people to like believe that like this is permanent, when that's not really the case. It's crazy because, like, yeah, like, obviously, like, in our lifetime, we only ever know, like, our span of, like, however many decades we're going to be here. But, like, when you take, like, steps back, you're like, oh, yeah, this, like, you know, USA has been around for 200 plus years. That's not anything in, like, the exchange. So, like, thinking of, like, this, like, American-based, like, Republican society versus, like, other versions of things that have existed over, like, you know, the span of time, this shows you that, like, yeah, there's so many other possibilities. There's so many other ways of existing.
Yeah.
I think we have to just you know, I think the fun part is imagining all the possibilities, because I think you can never, like, build something that you haven't already, like, imagined first, right?
True.
I think that's
maybe
the thing we can do.
So let's talk about IG activism.
Yeah. going hand in hand with all these like current events is crazy. I feel like all I see is just like a lot of finger wagging at each other, at like people themselves. Like, you know, one day somebody posts you know, a story, like a non-black POC post a story, you know, dripped heavy and like AAVE, and then the next day they're like all POCs that aren't black that like use AAVE, you're fucked up, you guys aren't like supporting, you guys aren't down for solidarity. And then like we were talking about earlier, like white people being like, don't spread black death, and then like the very next day spreading black death, or like, it's insane, the disconnect within individual like users and like people like you follow or I follow like on social media. It's like, weren't you just like 3 days ago doing the thing that you're now accusing everybody of? And it always seems like everybody else is guilty, and the person wagging the finger is never guilty of anything. That right is always the accused, and like everybody's always above it, but it seems like everybody else is doing it. It's like, what is that reality? And it seems so empty now. It just, I mean, it just seems so ridiculous, and what is it beyond stories and posts, or even some of them are just reposts. Like, is reposting so much easier than posting your own thing too? And what is it beyond that? Is like, and then all even the posts that are like, it's so much more than Instagram posts, and it's like, I don't see this person doing anything other than posting Instagram posts. So I'm just so I'm
Instagram
so
gangster.
My mind just is boggled by the audacity, the absurdity of IG activism, and then the echo chambers, the cyclical nature of it all. I'm just
it just all comes back to this lack of critical analysis of both oneself and the viability and the limitations of these platforms, right? So, like, anyone who navigates these platforms know that each of them have their different functions, right? Instagram is specifically for, like, all the visual stuff. So you see, like, most of, like, visual artists on there, like, posting their wares. Twitter is for the academics and where you talk your shit and you test out writing bits and stuff, and you interact literature-wise, like with wording. And Facebook is kind of where the whitewashed version of yourself that you present to family and friends, right? Everybody kind of knows that, right?
Yeah.
None of these three things alone, or even together, acts as any kind of activism, quote unquote. Like, and I think at 2020, it's okay for us to go on ahead and admit that. You can use it as a tool for activism, which has been done. It's also been used as a tool against activism. That is currently happening, and we can see how that happened with some of the activists with Ferguson. But ultimately, these are public spaces that are owned by corporations. So I don't understand how any thinking human being who posts some shit in 2020 thinks that they're doing some incredible service to a group of people on any of these platforms.
Yeah, that's the thing. And I think, even in our very recent experience, it seems like, is it just the public attention? Like, I want people to know that I'm, like, about this thing, or
yes,
that I'm, like, down for this thing. Is that it? Is that what it's about? It's just, like, I need to post a story, let me post about, because I understand if, like, oh, there's, like, shit going on in the world, I'm gonna post about, like, my art, versus, right, like, oh, I don't want to be that person, there's shit going on in the world, let me post about that, so I can show people that I'm aware of what's going on, that I'm not so shallow, that I'll just post my own art or something.
Yeah.
Because it's like, what are all these people doing for? And they're like, what is all this, like, virtue signaling and, like, finger wagging of, like, you know, being like, don't do that, don't do this. Like, I can't believe my community is doing this thing. And then it's like, are you not doing that stuff too? Like, are you, like, I can't think of a single person I know in, like, my age range that's like a white person, or that's
Can you back up a little bit? You broke up a little bit in the past few seconds.
Yeah, I just said I can't think of a single person in my age range that I know who's white or a non-black POC that doesn't at some point use, like, AAVE in real life, on Instagram, on social media, you know, like, are you, and then acting like they don't, or acting like that's not the case, you know, in these, like, posts. It's like, what?
I mean, that's a good point, but you're not a little bit creeped out when, okay, suppose it's someone you know, and you know it's for a fact that they don't usually use AAVE when you're talking to them, but when you see them posted up on social media, they throw in all this miscellaneous AAVE for no goddamn reason. That wouldn't creep you out a little bit?
No, that does creep me out. I'm very creeped out by people like that. There's a few people in particular that I'm downright surprised by their flagrancy with AAVE, these very, archetypical white people, mm-hmm, you know, that say they're about all these things, and then will just, like, act like they're, cool, or some fucking, they're digital blackface.
Yeah.
it's ridiculous, and it seems so separate. Like they're able to like completely detach from things they say at a different point in time.
Yeah, it's a minefield. Like
Go ahead.
I mean, and like it's not just limited to on social media. Like you and I definitely both know people, because I've seen it happen to you, just as I'm sure you've seen it happen to me. People who you know are as white as the driven snow, who are like talking normally, and then the minute they approach you, they throw in some random ass slang from 1995, for no goddamn reason. Like, who asked you to do this?
Yeah, like, no, I'll agree with them and say I too think that is whack. yeah, no, it's so weird the gymnastics people can do, the mental gymnastics people can do.
Yeah. Let's go on ahead and launch into Seely's glass of water, which is a special shout out for the folks who are doing the most with not even the least.
Old Mr. Talking Trash About Suge. Folks don't like nobody being too proud or too free. Not if you know more than a juke joint Jezebel.
Today's glass goes out to Shameik Moore, aka Miles Morales. So, earlier this morning, young Shameik had some hot takes about the recent rounds of police brutality, or as I prefer to call it, murder. Rather than keeping them to himself or writing it down in his dream journal, he decided to take advantage of his 240 characters and let the whole world know what he thought. Here are some of those tweets. See, I have some very... Okay, first of all, he posted a video of some black violence, some black death. That was hint number one. And accompanying that video, he tweeted, "See, I have some very strong opinion that the black community hates to hear, but needs to hear. We need to learn how to deal with police and or racism, because this is the part of the scenario we have failed to fix."
We have failed to fix.
Mm-hmm. And did he stop there?
Nope.
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 He did not. He kept going. Here's some more. "We have to work on our community before blaming everything on, quote, racist, unquote, and police. One, there is still black-on-black violence that needs to be addressed. And two, if we know that the wrong white person could change our whole life with a false accusation, ... I just feel the solution is not to continue to handle the situation the way we've been handling it. There are no results. That is literally the definition of insanity." And I would like to point out at this point that Roxane Gay, who, you know, there have been some mixed receptions of her, but she very kindly and generously pointed out in response to his second tweet before he went on to let the chopper spray, as they say, "You need to go read several books because this is not your lane and you are embarrassing yourself." Okay. Did he listen, Max? Did he listen to that sage advice?
No, he did not.
No, he did not. Let's continue. "Why do we give them the energy they want?" That was all in caps, y'all. "Give them an inch and they will take a mile. We literally know this already. At what point do we look at ourselves and make adjustments?" He goes on. "No one asked for my opinion." You're right, Shameik, no one did ask for your opinion. "But it's 2020, not 1945. Meaning, I'm more focused on black futures," futures is in caps, y'all, that's how you know it's serious, "than black history. I personally refuse to feel like a victim. I refuse to have a slave mentality. I don't not fear for my life because I know how to carry myself in tough situations." And tough is spelled T-U-F-F, y'all. Here's some more. And I know there are many of us that have literally never experienced a cop or racist hunting you down for your life. I'm pro-life, but I'm obviously black, so don't misunderstand what I'm saying. Black lives shouldn't be taken so heartlessly. All right. So, after getting appropriately dragged in various degrees of politeness, he then quadrupled down on this fuckery and posted some videos where you could see his face matched with the voice of all this nonsense. Now look, from this nonsense, I can only assume one of two things happened here. Either Shamik has gone full-on Candace Owens and started getting those big publishers' clearinghouse checks for spewing racist, white supremacist nonsense. And honestly, in today's economy, I have made peace with the fact that we're going to lose some folks to capitalism. It is what it is. Or, and this is perhaps the most likely of the two, this young man is drowning in the same sea of despair that we all are, and is looking for a perspective that allows the illusion of agency and control in this centuries-old situation we got going on with this country. And look, I get it. In some ways, it's almost easier to believe that it's somehow our fault. That way we can change it, right? However, the arrogance and historical amnesia required to believe and say this bullshit is so astounding that it hurts my head to think about. And then to publicly say it out loud, whew, I don't really want to understand that life, to be honest. At the end of the day, young Shamik, you could have just sat there and ate your food. You could have said nothing, which is not only free, but tax deductible. When given the choice between saying something that will hurt a large number of people and is based on lies, or saying absolutely nothing and continuing to secure the bag, why not go with the latter? What informs these kinds of choices? Where are your friends? Where are your people? In conclusion, and I say this with love, please shut your goofy ass up. Okay. And on that note, we are going to end with parting words. Max, what are your parting words?
My parting words are, I'm late for a meeting, and that reminds me of something my grandma would always say when we were kids. I guess when she was in high school, back in like the 40s, she played, they did the play Alice in Wonderland, and she was a rat. And the line she would always repeat was, I'm late for a very important date. So, that's my parting word with that add-on story.
Nicely done. All right. And my parting words are twofold. One, we know who really set those fires. And two, black folks, stay as safe as you can out there, especially those who are putting their lives on the line for the rest of us. And for those of us who are just watching, let's do better at learning when to shut the fuck up. All right.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Bye, y'all.